recruitment technology actually come from, you know, sales, or they come from some other background that isn't necessarily building. And I really love the fact you brought it back in with the title of the book saying talent makers, because, you know, you're both makers to a large degree, which is great stuff. Anyway, we're live, everybody. So welcome to Founders Focus. This is episode number 9, where this is the show where we get up close and personal with the folks that are building the technology that is changing the way in which we work today. And I'm super excited to do this show, particularly because the software, the Greenhouse software, I believe, was the last proper ATS I used when I was still an active recruiter. So in my last job, if you like, the last job I had, which I think was quite early for Greenhouse, especially in the UK market, somebody implemented it. Now I took a look at it for the first time and I thought, wow, this actually looks and feels really different. And one of my regrets as to leaving that job was actually not to be able to play with the software even more, which, as any product maker knows, is a very good sign that you at least have the UX right, and at least you have the flow right when the user actually wants to use it and isn't wrestling with the thing and isn't battling with it. So anyway, we have the founders of Greenhouse, folks, with us today, John Stross and Daniel Chait. So John and Daniel, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having us.
Thanks for having us. Great to be here.
It's great. A quick sound check, everybody. So I just want to make sure everyone can hear me okay. I think we're okay on Crowdcast. We are live on multi channels here. So I hope everyone can hear me on LinkedIn. If so, let me know. Give me some indication that we're okay there. I think I am. I just pressed the wrong thing. Facebook, I think we're live there also. We're out on Periscope as well. So we're multi-channel, multi-broadcasting. Everybody's going to see
this.
King
of all media. I love it.
Yeah, yeah. May as well do it all in one go, you know. No need to redistribute. We're going to do it all in one shot. Anyway, you two are super busy. When I launched the show, sort of Founders Focus, I had two minds whether I wanted to do it, because I felt like quite guilty that I'd be bringing sort of these senior folks in charge of multi-million-dollar businesses away from their day-to-day having a chat with me. And I'm thinking, oh my God, how much am I costing the company by having them have a chat with me for half an hour? So I want to thank you both for joining us. And let's get real. What did you cancel in order to do Founders Focus today? Was there anything like super important that you have to shove to one side in order to appear here?
Okay. No, I don't think so. I mean, I think obviously this is an exciting opportunity. I read your newsletter. And so, you know, the chance to come on and talk to you was a cool one.
You're basically saying that, you know, being the CEO, being the C-level sort of drivers of Greenhouse is a very easy job. You know, it's like, hey.
This conversation is much, much more fun than working, believe me.
That's great stuff. Okay, let's dive into, like, one of the things we wanted to do here was to figure out like how it is for you two personally being the founders of what is now a super successful recruitment technology business. I mean, what does the day look like for you two? Is there like any pattern that we need to be aware of? How do you divide the work? Is there anything that you do regularly day to day? Is there something that that is always happening every day? Anything you can share with us on that?
Yeah, I mean, I think the thing that strikes me, Hung, when you ask that question is, as any startup, you know, founder or leader, how dynamic the job is, how much it changes. And so, you know, when you're just getting started and you're a seed stage, you know, company, I remember it wasn't that long ago, it was just John and me and a PowerPoint. You know, the way you spend your time is very different. And then you raise some money and you hire some employees, you get some customers. Now you're 50 people. Now you're 200 people. You know, now we're over 500 employees. We have offices in multiple countries and locations. We have thousands of customers. Like, the job continuously changes. And so for me, that's what keeps it interesting, for one thing. Like, I don't know that I'm the type of person that just wants to come in and do the same thing every day for years and years. But you have to be very intentional about it. You know, I spend time at least a couple times a year refocusing my priorities. I basically look at, you know, what are my top kind of three or four priorities that I want to be spending time on? And then I go look at my calendar and I add up how many hours I'm spending time on various things. And invariably they have nothing to do with each other. And so you rebalance and you figure out what am I going to cut and what am I going to add and how am I going to redo it? And then, you know, you get closer to where you want to be. And then, you know, 6 months later, you find out that it's all different.
You know what, that type of management of time is so important, isn't it? I've heard it said that when you're at sea level, like the things that you say no to are actually much more important than the things you say yes to. Because your job is always, I guess it's like a long sequence of demands, isn't it? Like people like asking you to do stuff, asking you to make decisions. How do you kind of discipline yourself to implement this resetting and this idea that you need to kind of be clear on the North Star? Is this something that was something you've always had, or was it something that you had to be trained to do? Was there a moment where you realized actually this is something you need to do in order to be successful leading a business like this?
I felt like it came from, I remember working and one of our executives started doing it and we were watching like, oh, that's really smart. I should do that. And then when you do the exercise that Dan just described of comparing what your priorities are to where you're spending your time, you have this aha moment. For me, like the specific thing was it's really easy for internal things to eat up all the time. You spend all of your time in meetings and managing people and hiring and like it's all great. And the thing that goes away is you stop talking to customers. And so for me, I created like a specific, I have a personal KPI of how many customers and prospects I talk to every month. And I track it in a spreadsheet and I try to goal myself and I get very upset if I don't make it. And that's forced me to like stay close to what's actually happening and not just be like in some ivory tower and be kind of worthless.
I love that. So basically you need to kind of create your own system outside of all of the company systems in order to do those personal management activities. And I think, you know what, that's actually a really important detail that probably all of us need to think about, because having moved to a distributed way of working, let's say that everyone is now, you know, the requirement to self-manage is now much higher priority than it was before. Yeah. Previously, you know, you could be lazy, come into the office and have your boss tell you what to do. Well, guess what? The boss isn't always visible and definitely not looking at everything you're doing. You have to reset your priorities and understand what it is that's important for you to do. So, John, you mentioned that you wanted to speak to customers. Is obviously everyone's going to say that's important, but why was that something that's like very much in the front of your mind? Is that something to do with background, or is it something to do with your experience in product dev, or what?
Yeah, I mean, I've been a product manager more or less for like 25 years, and the kind of currency of product management in a lot of ways is customer insights. You know, if you understand the customer the best, you can probably build the best product. And so even though we have a whole product team and they're probably like, yeah, leave us alone, we're figuring it out, I still feel for me, like if I don't have a good sense of what's going on with customers, like what am I even doing here? I'm kind of worthless at that point. And so I have to keep talking to customers and bouncing ideas off of them and hearing what they're struggling with. And I also just get a lot of energy from that. So I enjoy it.
Yeah, yeah. I just had a thought as well. I mean, aren't you a nightmare person for the product team? It's like...
So I mean, we talk about it a lot because it's a cliche, right? Is like the founder who won't give up the product. And so we get pretty intentional about that, of having me not be like micromanaging and saying, oh, do it this way and do it that way. And so we've had to work on that to make sure that I'm not a nightmare for the product team.
Let's analyze that, because you're coming from product side, John, you're coming from the software side. Both of you have had to step back from these operational roles, right? I mean, at some point, it is your baby. You're always going to think this is how it should be done. When did you, like, how do you deal with this situation where maybe you have a very strong, passionate opinion of it being this way, but you've hired this person to do this job, to make that decision, and you've got to, you know, allow that person to make that call. Like, how did you, was there a moment when you realized, okay, you got to wrestle this through and actually step away?
I mean, I just think about early on, you know, we thought about Greenhouse as, you know, we're trying to build a big company. We're tackling a big, important mission to help every company become great at hiring. That's going to take a lot of people's efforts. It's not something John and I can do alone. And so we chose very intentionally, we want to build a venture scale company that's going to, you know, solve this kind of global problem. And so when you start that way, you kind of baked into the cake that you're going to, you know, give up your give up your responsibilities as you build out. And so we always thought in the early days, I'm just casting my mind back to like 2012, 2013, we're just getting going. It was like, we didn't know how Greenhouse was going to work yet. You know, we just didn't know if it was going to work. And so we thought about it as a series of like experiments. What do we need to learn? Do we actually understand the customer problem? Do we actually understand the opportunity? Is the solution we have in mind a reasonable solution? Is it going to work? How do we convince a customer to switch from brand X to Greenhouse? How much money are they going to pay? How do we sell it? How do we make them successful? And so on. And I think as entrepreneurs, like we're kind of well suited to doing those early experimental questions, figuring out how's it even going to work? Is it even going to work? Once you've got a playbook that kind of has worked 25, 30, 40, 50 times, then you go, okay, now I could imagine bringing someone in who probably is better at that job, who's probably got more specialized skill in sales or in customer success or in product management or these other areas to operationalize it and scale it. But like the first in to really take the gamble when you don't even know if it's going to work and kind of figure it out, I think a founder is a great role for that. So I think even now, like we think of ourselves in kind of that way. And I was actually listening to the earlier answer. I was thinking, well, yeah, we have all these great talented people on the product team. You know, why is John out there talking to customers? And the truth is there's a conversation that John can have with a lot of customers that not everyone can have because he's the founder of the company. And so that gives you a certain amount of permission, you know, to be in the room in ways that everyone necessarily can't. And we try to use that.
Yeah, I totally get it. And I love the fact that you mentioned you still have that, if you like, see yourselves as the experimenters of stuff like this. So whereas there's constraints, obviously, with, you know, when you're doing product, there's always going to be different constraints that will stop you from doing, you know, moonshot type activities or whatnot. But maybe, you know, you've got more freedom to do it given your role and your stature within the business and the industry.
Mm-hmm. That's right. And I also think there's like a bit of a misconception that like, oh, we're the founders, so we know. And we are really smart. And if we let other people make decisions, they'll make worse decisions than us because we're so smart. It's like, yeah, that's not really the case, right? The thing that Dan just said is like we're creating a way that we could like quickly experiment and learn. That's the magic, not like some idea that I have. Like, what do I know about recruiting software? And so it's really about like bring people in so you can scale it up and everybody can kind of run those experiments and get close to customers and listen. So it wasn't like, oh my gosh, I'm letting other people make decisions about the product that I would make better. I'm like, I never really felt that actually.
You know, I think that now that I'm chatting with you guys, I think the fact that there was, you know, really from the very beginning, a vision as to where you wanted to take it is has been a super important element of your ability to make those calls as you go through. You know, a lot of people maybe weren't as intentional with a lot of this and didn't have those things in place. And perhaps, you know, the cliche of the founder, the tech founder, should we say, you know, still, you know, getting in amongst the decision making and the architecture level or whatnot, you know, that's something that might occur if the person didn't think on, you know, scaling it in the first with the first kernel of the idea.
Yeah, and if you know, we talk about this in the book too, right? This idea of like talent makers that you know it's so important to get out there and win for top talent. You know, we put all this effort into being smart about hiring and hiring and competing for the best talent. And you know, why are you going to bother doing that if you're just going to like micromanage them and tell them what to do and make all the decisions for them? Hiring worse people is way easier. Do you know what I mean? So it's like, so if you're going to put all this effort into great people, then why would you possibly get in the way of them doing the best work of their careers and adding the most value that they can? Like, it just doesn't make any sense.
You've just caused me to think of a situation here, Dan, which is, would it make sense then to hire a different type of talent if you are inherently a micromanager? Like if you are self-aware enough to know that's the case, then you should not be hiring these, you know, entrepreneurial innovative types because you can't get out of their way. You need to hire the people that are just going to execute or do whatever. In fact, now that I've come, a friend of mine actually does this. Shout out to my mate, Dan. I mean, he's another Dan. He runs a recruitment agency. He did actually tell me one time, say, listen, I don't actually hire the best people.
That's an employee value proposition.
Right. Tell us last name, this last name secret. He said, "Hang on, don't hire the right people. I just need like mediocre people that are going to stay with me 3 years and do what I tell them to do." And I'm thinking, fair play, man. I mean,
okay, I disagree with almost everything you're saying, but there's a kernel of truth in there, I think. Which is to say, like, I actually disagree with this general idea that like there's better people and worse people, and the job of a hiring company is like rank. Ideally, everyone in the universe, you know, everyone in the world, all 7 billion of us from best to worst, and then hire the best. Like, it don't work that way. People are nuanced and complicated, and what we like doing, and what we want to do, and what we're good at, and, you know, those things change over time. And I think there is a truth to the fact that in some jobs, you want someone who's going to take the job seriously and be dependable and show up every day and do their work, stay a long time. You know, if you've got a job that's highly operational, involves a lot of routine, and you hired me for it, I would be terrible at it. I would be bored. Like, so hiring someone that's going to be satisfied and going to think it's a good job. And I'm reminded back when we were getting started, and one of the things that we found after we had a number of customers is that often we were replacing, you know, some existing software, some other ATS with Greenhouse, and the customers would want us to take their data, all the resumes and applicants and notes that they had in the other system, and bring them into Greenhouse. And we were doing that a bunch, and our kind of engineers were sort of complaining about it. Like, look, we want to be building new features and doing cool stuff. We don't want to be munging around in some old database, you know, of some other vendor. And we went out to try to hire this like data migrations team. And at first it was this real problem. It's like, man, you know, all the good engineers don't want to do this work. And what it took was like the term of art, I think, is job crafting, like kind of reconceptualizing what the work meant and thinking like, for someone, this is their ideal job. Who is that person and why do they think this job is ideal? And it turns out that there are people who view this as kind of almost like a puzzle or a mystery. Like every day I come into work and my customers need data out of a system that's probably written by a rival of ours that doesn't want to talk to us. We don't have any documentation. There's a hard time limit. The data is really important. I got to crack the code of getting that out and getting the Greenhouse before the go live date. That's a cool problem to work on. And we found people that are amazing at it. And now it's, of course, a whole team and a whole process here. And so I do think that, all jokes aside, hiring the right person for the job and finding out who's that best person that you can, you know, put in the place to do their best work is a real thing.
Do we agree with that, folks? I mean, I would love to hear your thoughts on this. Is it wrong to just do basically a rank, like an quote-unquote objective rank of talent, which is how we talk about talent, by the way? You know, when we go out there, oh, we want elite talent and whatever, we're kind of not talking about what job it is they're talking about, just thinking elite means elite, irrespective of whatever job it is. Is that actually too crude a way to think about it? And is it really context-specific? In other words, what is the best talent means, what is the best fit for that particular job, and even for that particular company? Like my friend's Dan company, he will tell you straight away, it's not particularly innovative. He does like SAP recruitment in Europe, very simple, right? And by the way, I've given you a lot of clues, so you can look this guy up now. But he does this very, very simple, very straightforward, like zero innovation, but he makes a ton of money and his business is doing really great. And he's saying, look, this is the machine, he knows how to oil it. And I'm thinking, you know what, that's maybe the first thing you've got to recognize as a recruiter is what kind of business you are. And then you've got to kind of understand how that then cascades to what your recruiting strategy might be. And not be fighting, if you like, for what is quote unquote the elite talent necessarily, because it may not be elite for you. It could be entirely the wrong person.
And it's actually one of the most important parts of a recruiting process, that kickoff meeting where you've got your hiring manager and your recruiter, you know, getting together and actually talking about what are the criteria for success? What is the ideal person for this job look like? And if you skip that step and you're just like, oh, hire the best. Well, you know, chances are what I have in my mind about what's best and what the hiring manager has with their mind is best. Not to mention all the interviewers are going to stick in rooms without any guidance and say, hey, go tell me if this person's good. You're gonna get chaos. You're gonna get a mess. And so that kind of idea of structured hiring is really all about getting everyone on the same page and making sure that you're clear and explicit about those needs. Because even within a given company, I mean, if you talk about a job here at Greenhouse, for example, when we were 50 people or 75 people, you know, versus where we are now, versus where we're going to be in 5 years from now, those are different jobs. It's different context. We have different customers. I mean, who's right for that job is just different.
There's two things. I mean, we're going to jump straight into this because we're already talking about job crafting, and I was going to talk about this later, but let's dive into it because it's a big component in structured hiring, of course, big component of the talent maker's vision. Can you tell us a little bit more about how you decided to pull all of that together and where you got it from? Because, you know, it'd be fascinating to know, you know, how this sort of crystallized into a philosophy over the course of time that you spent building Greenhouse. So firstly, about Talent Makers, this is a book that's been published, I think, earlier this year, wasn't it? For the first book that these two guys co-authored, brilliant tome. Definitely get yourself a copy of this. And tell us a little bit about sort of where the idea of creating a book came out of and how it crystallized into I think, what a, you know, as a philosophy of hiring.
Go for it.
No, go ahead. I've been talking too much.
Okay. I mean, I think the talent maker concept kind of emerged over the last few years as we were realizing more and more companies were having this kind of light bulb moment of like, hiring is not this like administrative burden. It's a strategic function. We're going to win or lose at hiring. We're going to lose as a business based on our ability to hire well. And there's all this attention paid to from the recruiter side. What does a recruiter need to do? And what we're finding is there's this big gap of like from the business side, from the business partner, your hiring manager, your executives, what's their responsibility? How do they play their role? And what we realize is in companies where that hadn't been figured out, where the CEO or the head of engineering did not realize, like they're saying hiring's important, but they weren't sure what to do, you're really struggling to make progress. And so we kind of coined this phrase talent maker around, let's define the playbook for that person. That they have to, those three things, they have to be a talent magnet, that they themselves have to go out and attract talent and convince people to come in. They have to be a talent leader in terms of how they set the culture in their company around hiring. And they have to be a talent partner of how do they partner directly with that talent acquisition team. And in laying that out, we realized, this is actually a whole philosophy for talent or for business leaders to figure out how to play their role. And so we figured out how do we get to those folks and tell that story. And we thought a book was another good way to get there. And we've gotten a lot of feedback towards that from recruiters who say, this is what I've been trying to say the whole time. This is like, I totally knew all of this. This is super obvious to me and nobody else in my company knows this. And so I'm actually giving it to my exec team or my main partner and saying, please read this. This is what we're actually trying to do at our company. And I think that's where it's actually had the most impact.
Yeah, fantastic. And obviously, you know, recruiters are often poorly equipped to have internal conversations, I find. I'm not sure why that is, but it maybe it's because of the operational pressure. Like straight away, you've got like 150 people to hire. You don't have the time, so to speak. But actually, those internal conversations are the most important ones recruiters can have, and we need to be equipped to do it. You know, we need tools like the book, and we also need training, I think, to have those conversations with management. Okay. Let's have a look at sort of the journey you guys are from. So let's time shift back. Both of you are working in kind of a corporate space. You're both doing tech. You're both working for these big businesses. How did it come about that you thought, yeah, let's build some recruitment technology? It was like, what was the moment where that happened?
Do you want to tell the story?
Yeah, well, I mean, so I've been kind of an entrepreneur my whole career, Hung, and I'd started this company in the early 2000s and sold it around 2010. John similarly had been an entrepreneur and built this business, sold it to J&J, as you said, big company, flew around the world, setting up their offices around the world and had left J&J. And so we were each kind of thinking about what our next step was. Now, if you may not know this, John and I were friends in college. And so we had met in the mid 90s at University of Michigan. Fun fact, John had joined my brother and I had an intramural basketball team called the J Brothers Flying Circus. And John was the point guard on our basketball team. I say that to say we didn't really know each other as business people. Let's put it that way. We never worked together. John was on the West Coast. He did this thing called product management. I have an engineering degree. I know what the hell product management was. Can't program. How do you make products? What does that even mean? And similarly, you know, John had done all this big stuff. And I was like in this weird like Wall Street world. And so we spent time together over that summer. But I think we each had the idea in our head that we were going to go pursue some next step of our own. My recollection of that moment was I started to see, like, as more and more I'm spending with this guy, I'm like, wow, he's a friend of mine. I like him, but holy crap, he's really smart. I really like working with
him. I thought all my friends were dumb kind of thing.
And then you just don't know. You know, I had all kinds of friends. And I wouldn't start businesses with most of them. But the more time John and I spent together, the more we realized that, like, there's a lot of chemistry here. There's a great, you know, we like each other a lot. We trust each other a lot. And also we're good at very different things. And so let's find a problem to work on together. We got really excited. We came up with some big world-changing ideas, some innovative trends that were affecting the entire globe, and hung every single one of them proved to be worse than the last. I mean, we made a spreadsheet and criteria, and we grinded away at this thing over the summer with idea.
Give us some of those. What was on row like 2 and 3? Let's understand what these options were, guys.
What are some of them, John? I think we had this idea that, like, companies in Africa were going to skip the PC and go straight to mobile phones and run their whole businesses on their phones. And so that was a big opportunity. I don't know. We had an idea for a crowdsource driven hedge fund. I mean, all kinds of wacky stuff.
I hated that.
All of these things will happen, by the way. All of these things are absolutely going to happen. It's all our timing. Yeah.
They might. But it was not to be. And so eventually we kind of got to the list and we ran out of ideas. And finally we thought, like, is there anything that we know how to do? Because those all may be great ideas, but what the hell do I know about running a business in Africa or starting a hedge fund? And so John asked that question, like, what is it that we know how to do? I was like, well, I don't know. I've been running HR and hiring at my Wall Street company for the last decade. And he says, yeah, you know, I've been hiring these businesses all around the world as part of this J&J business. Gosh, it's really interesting that everyone you talk to seems that they don't have hiring figured out. It seems like it's not that big a deal. You just make a process, you organize it, and you get it all done. And it's like a really important part of how you build a company. And as we started talking, we're like, hiring is one of the most important things for any organization. That seems pretty obvious. Most organizations are terrible at it. That seems pretty obvious. And we think that, like, when they try these steps that we didn't invent or anything, but when you look at the way a company can succeed at it, like, it works, it creates a lot of value. And so there was this moment, John talked about this light bulb moment, where we did realize, like, oh, wait a sec. This might be the big opportunity. And how do we know it was a good one? John, maybe you can tell that part of the story.
Yeah, I mean, and it happened like that. Like it just spilled out of Dan's mouth. He's like, everybody we talk to is, like, terrible and struggling at hiring. And we figured it out. Like, if everybody was good at hiring, wouldn't that be valuable? And so the first thing we did is we actually created a paper, like, structured interviewing was, like, in Dan's head. He'd already, like, been doing it. And so we just created a paper version of the product with, like, colored note cards and stuff that, like, literally on the first day. And then we started taking that around to, like, people we knew who were hiring and saying, okay, let's figure out your hiring process using these note cards. And we would do it. And people are like, I mean, literally 10 minutes, they'd be like, whoa, that's totally different than what I'm doing today. This seems way better. Can I use this? I'm like, ah. Oh. And then Dan had the idea. He's like, we knew people at General Assembly, which is, like, an education company here in New York. And we said, we want to teach a course on how to make hiring a strength of your company. We want to see if anybody would show up, and we talk and see what they say. And, like, it sold out immediately. And we're like, wow, a lot of people are interested in this. And it was, like, recruiters, non-recruiters, big company, small company. And they got there and we're like, wow, look, all these people came. Dan, do you have anything to say? And he got up and he riffed for 3 hours. And people are like, this is amazing. And we're like, I think we might have something here. That was all before we decided to, like, start the company. We're just doing that kind of customer development research stuff. And so this was just, like, we then figured out, oh, there's this whole ATS market thing. And we had a brief moment where it was like, you know, you Google ATSs and you're like, oh, there's Infinity. that's intimidating. Like, does the world really need another one of these things? And the insight we had is, like, well, the thing we're talking about is we want to help people be great at hiring. And nearly everybody's terrible. So it's a really unsolved problem. So while there are hundreds of ATSs and everybody's got one, whatever problems they set out to solve, they didn't solve our problem. And so I think that really set us off on this course where we thought we were solving a different problem than what everybody else had set off to. And that's why we did something different.
Yeah, fantastic. I hope you still have those note cards, by the way, because
I can't find them. Do you know where they are? We've moved offices so many times, like, they're somewhere, but, you know.
The historical artifacts. I mean, if you guys don't have a greenhouse museum somewhere, like, that thing should be, like, exhibit A.
We have, like, a whole history of greenhouse t-shirts. We have a lot of t-shirts, but I don't know where the note cards are these days.
Okay, so let's talk about Greenhouse. Why the name? I mean, did that pop into someone's head, or was that like a marketing thing? Like, why is it called Greenhouse?
Sorry,
there's a lot of versions of the story, and some of them are hilarious. And
it's a good question, Hung, because it gets into the mindset of a founder and the things that you obsess about. That I don't know how much they matter. But, you know, we struggled with what do we call the company. And we knew that, to John's point, we knew we were doing something different. And so we knew we wanted to name it something different. And we looked at the industry, we're like, oh, geez, there's a bunch of companies that have very concrete, what we thought was fairly boring functional names that have the word recruiter or job or resume in the title. We're like, doesn't really give you the scope to like think bigger and kind of like imagine what you could be. And on the other end, there's these purely meaningless names that like sound like
acronyms,
companies like Adecco and Taleo and Conexa. And it's just like, no offense to those companies, but those names don't say anything. And so we kind of wanted something that would be the best of both worlds. It would give us a little bit of freedom to sort of not anchor us down to one particular product or solution, but also that had a little bit of an emotional resonance that we thought we could build a brand around. And so we actually hired a consultant. She runs an agency that names things, companies and products. And we exchanged some, we bartered because it was early days. So we bartered some, you know, services to her for her help in helping us name the company. And she walked us through this exercise of, okay, you want to evoke some emotions. What are those emotions? We thought about growth and openness and light and kind of warmth and humanity and stuff. And we ran a bunch of names by us, and Greenhouse kind of stood out. And so we, you know, it seemed pretty easy. The one trap that we, I think, had fallen into that she helped us get out of is, you know, everyone starts by going to like what websites are available. And of course, there's no good .com, you know, names available. And she was like, you can't do that. Start with the name, build the brand, and then you find a website. That's why we're Greenhouse.io, which people sometimes wonder, like, why is it that?
It's still the coolest domain though, isn't it? Although you're now seeing XYZ start appearing as the latest coolest thing. But I think IO was the cool thing for at least a decade or so. So you're doing
and anybody
great.
That knows me and John, you know that being cool is cool.
That's our thing. Yeah,
super cool. Self-evident, man. I mean, I don't think anybody would have a doubt watching this show. but you know, I don't think that's a trivial thing how you name the company, because the aesthetics and the emotions that you evoke. This is how I started the conversation. The emotions I had when I was using the product was a big part of it. And it seems that that's cascaded through the product development, cascaded through how you treat customers and think about the market. It's all about, can you make it better? The feeling of like sunlight coming through just helps, because recruitment is really hard. And it can be extremely tough. Like mentally, it can be a very tough job. There's a friend of mine actually run a kind of a survey, and he talked about, is recruiting actually the most stressful job out there, and the highest level of anxiety. And obviously there's, you know, very serious jobs that are far in excess of this. However, there was a case to be made that because recruiting is so contingent upon other human beings, there's so many other human beings out there making your day a good or bad day, it might actually be right up there in terms of anxiety, because you can't predict whether you're going to have a good day. So you better have a tooling that you actually have a little bit of joy using rather than having to wrestle with stuff.
I would say there's a lonely job. Right, is that you're sitting there and you're mostly saying no to people and ruining their day. Like, you're mostly the worst thing that happens to somebody each day is you rejected them for a job. And then like your hiring managers like they're sort of your partners, but they're sort of sometimes a little adversarial. And so a lot of times I talk to a lot of recruiting leaders and they're like, yeah, there's nobody really to like compare notes with. And that's why we always found our conferences like Greenhouse Open, people just love them. I'm like, why? God, like, events are so hard. Why do you guys love these things? And they're like, this is the only time I get to really hang out with people like me who have my same challenges, and I get to really connect and say, how are you solving these things? And so I think it's going to be a very isolating job in a way, even though you're dealing with people all day, they're not actually peers. And so I think that could be a real struggle for a lot of people.
You know, that's a really interesting insight. And folks, recruiters who are listening to this, I wonder whether you agree or not. Please let me know in the comments, is it a lonely job? I think for particularly if you're a one person in a, let's say a startup and you're the first person in, I think super lonely job. Because I noticed this actually, my recruiting career was almost exclusively, when I was in-house, almost exclusively rapid growth, you know, funded startup type stuff. And I found it really lonely when all everyone else was doing stand-ups and I was the only guy sitting down.
Yeah,
that's right. I was like, you know, am I really part of the team? And it was like, because, you know, product and tech, back early stage, everyone's product and tech. So of course they're all together. And then you're sitting out there and you're trying to help. And it's like, okay, there's no one else you can talk to. And actually, I think there's a, thankfully, over the last 10, 15 years, we've seen a movement of online communities happen where recruiters are interacting. And I think that's really helped solve that problem. You guys building conferences is a big part of that also, because it kind of creates that intra-company information flow, which probably 20 years ago was never going to happen. I mean, you would literally be sitting by yourself all the way through, and then you'd have no way to exchange that information.
I'm always struck when I go talk to customers at how, you know, because I go talk to 20 or whatever, and like you ask them the same questions, and you hear who's doing things differently the same. I'm always struck that, like, wow, you guys never do this, do you? Like, you're just, because they're one of their main questions is like, are we weird, or is everybody doing what we're doing, or are we the only ones with this problem? It's like, wow, you really don't have another outlet to go find other people to compare notes with.
It's actually a really good marketing play as well. If you can provide industry-wide type stuff, like benchmarking type information, which I think companies of your category can do so, it's super interesting. Like, one thing I've realized is actually no recruiter knows what a good number is. Like, they know their own numbers, but they don't have the ability to compare necessarily to others, so they can't tell the market. It's, I think, vendors like yourselves that have that opportunity to do that. Okay, let's talk about the trajectory of the company. And I want to talk specifically about how you changed the business as it changed. There is a philosophy that the early folks that you bring in are going to do the job at this moment. They're not going to be optimal for the next moment, and you need to get different types of people coming in. Does this kind of sync very nicely with the funding rounds or the growth of the business, or does it sort of emerge over time and you realize actually, you know, this person was amazing or this team was amazing for that moment in time? We need to repurpose this group, and we need to bring other people in. Like, how do you handle a dynamic business? I guess a business that changes.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know that it lines up so neatly to, like, you know, a funding round necessarily, but certainly it has to do, I think, a lot with the scale of the organization, and just kind of a simple rule of thumb is you can think like the average sort of span of control of a manager is somewhere between, you know, 5 to 9 people, right? And so if you have, you know, 50 people, you know, that's a different, you know, tree than if you have 150 people. And so there's these kind of natural breakpoints where, you know, your top people are doing the work directly, your top people are managing the people doing the work directly, your top people are second line managers or third line managers. And each time you have to add like a new level, it kind of ripples through the org and everyone's job like shifts in certain ways. And so, you know, to your question, well, we're very lucky that we have people who've been with us for 7 or 8 or 9 years now. And we also have a lot of people who've come and done some time with the company for a few years and then, you know, realized that they wanted to go do something else or weren't the right fit for the next job. I think that's very natural at a startup, you know, at a growing company, where, you know, as you said, I mean, the needs are changing and, you know, what we're doing is changing a lot. So, I think the key for me is not being afraid to know when it's time, you know, when it's time for someone, you know, to do something else, which is not working, and being somewhat objective about that is the hard part, right? Because you become attached to your people. I mean, you care about them. You invest a lot of time getting them, and when it stops working or when you think they could be doing something else better, that can sometimes be a difficult realization.
Yeah, I think that's actually a real responsibility of leadership actually to take that decision on. I remember an old manager of mine, he had to let a colleague, a loved colleague, go, and I remember him saying to her, the worst thing he did was not make that decision sooner, because it's not suiting anybody to have someone struggle or not enjoying the role. You know, your job as the leader is actually to raise that early.
For sure. And conversely, you know, how do you know when there's somebody who, look, the job is changing, what you need out of them is totally different, but there's somebody that you think can step up, and, you know, who are you going to be able to place bets on and say, this person is on paper not at all qualified for the job we're going to go ask them to do next. But, you know, I'm going to elevate them into that role and provide them the support, you know, they need to succeed at it. And those bets that we've made are some of the most rewarding things I've done in my career. But again, they take some conviction and they can be hard to do.
A quick way to kind of a similar question, but with a slightly different angle. Companies' dynamic changes over time, and particularly when you're kind of a funded business, the idea is to change it rapidly. What is your take on company culture? Is it a view that you've got to kind of maintain a company culture, and there's techniques to do that as you grow? Or is it your take to say, actually, we have to accept this dynamism that will change, changing the business is going to change the culture. And what we've got to do is kind of almost like ride the beast a little bit rather than direct it overly much. Have you guys had conversations about this? And you know, what did you decide to do?
I think Dan has a good story of the early job that he had where the culture was so bad. And he's always lived in fear of creating a company that was anything like that. And so it's always been like, that's how I wake up every day. It's like, let's not let our company turn into that. I think the lesson for us was just, we were pretty intentional from our pretty early day of like not just letting culture be an implicit thing where like, well, we're the way we are and maybe people that'll rub off on people and maybe the company will turn into a good thing. It's like, no, let's be explicit. Like, what do we want the culture to be like? And how do we make that happen? How do we build that into the way that we hire, the way that we manage, the way that we communicate. And so those tactics have always evolved over time. And certainly you have to, things are flexible where like different offices are gonna have slightly different cultures, but there's some like bedrock things that you say are very greenhousey. And I think the key thing was how do we create systems that will reinforce that? So it's not about Dan or I's personality. It's not dependent on you sitting near us. It's that like, no, it's in the company. And so now I think most of the ways that people learn the culture or express the culture have really nothing to do with like anybody in leadership. It's like what's happening within Slack, honestly, as a remote company. And you see it happen. And I've heard people talk about how they greet new hires and ensure that like a new hire knows that there's a place for them and that the ERGs find people and say, hey, like you're welcome here. And there's a whole bunch of things that happen kind of organically throughout the company to kind of create that culture. So I don't know if that was a direct answer to your question, but it's
absolutely it is. Yeah. And one thing I really love about the industry is that culture has emerged from, if you like, academia, and it's kind of very much into the corporate world now in terms of conversation. You won't be having any conversation about leadership without the word culture being there and people thinking deeply about it, which is, I think, fantastic. Let's have a think about, there's a lot of people watching this and thinking, right, everything's changing. We're kind of remote. We're hybrid. We're doing all this. They have like high concerns right now about their company culture, don't they? What would you say it are kind of things that leaders can do to create the right culture for the business and even like correct scenarios where culture you can see is actually going in a direction you don't want to go. You've had experience of working with businesses where you had bad culture. So when do you see a flag and you think, you know what, we gotta step on this?
Well, I mean, it is hard, so I don't think I have like the answer, you know, in a bullet point or two. What I will say, maybe one observation as we've all moved into this kind of remote world is the illusion that people had when they were in the office that they knew what was happening because they could see all the people has now gone away. I think a lot of people felt like, you know, they're walking around and, hey, I'm the boss. Everyone says hi to me and kind of like, you know, they say nice things to me, like things are good. It's like, no, you don't ever hear the truth in that way. And you never know what's going on in people's home lives and you don't know what's happening behind closed doors or when you're not in the room. And I think that illusion is now gone. And I think people are faced with the reality embedded into your question, which is, what the heck are these people going through all day? What's actually going? You don't know. You know, the minute I close the Zoom, poof, the whole company disappears from my field of view. And so what that means is you really need to be much more intentional about putting time into talking to people, in one-on-one and in small group sessions, about asking people and giving people lots of channels for providing feedback, anonymous, non-anonymous, you know, public. You've really got to lean into holding yourself accountable. And so, for example, you know, every other Friday, John and I get on the company, get the company together. We do an all company AMA. Anyone can submit questions through a form. They're allowed to be anonymous. They can give us their name, or they can give their name to a trusted moderator, someone that won't tell us who they are, but who can follow up with questions or ask for more kind of insight into what the question meant. And then John and I's job is to stand up in front of the company every couple weeks to answer the questions. And it's just another way that we have to know, like, what's really on people's minds. And it doesn't even have to always be controversial stuff, although there are certainly those as well. It can just be like things that we haven't told them, or things that we haven't told them in ways that have landed. How does this work? Or what's on our product roadmap? And I can tear my hair out all day and say, geez, we've given you 14 product roadmap PowerPoints already. Why don't you know it? But like, they don't. So they ask the question, and then it gives us another way to like get, you know, in people's heads and kind of learn what needs to be said. And so, I don't know, I think things like that just need to become much more part of your fabric. And you can't just like follow your inbox or, you know, send your emails and do your meetings and go home. You really got to figure out what's happening in people's lives.
You know what? There's a friend of mine that runs a podcast called Value Through Vulnerability. And I think that's, you've just described that, where the leadership of the business is actually making themselves fully available to answer questions in public. And that kind of, I think, creates trust in the business. Like, they know this is happening every Friday. They know they can submit the question and get it asked. And they know these two are going to try and answer the question, even if the answer is not perfect or what they want to hear, or, you know, whatever it is, that they're going to give it a shot and actually address it. So I think that in itself is a significant cultural building block. And I think you'll find more, like, as I get older, I realize most people are quite forgiving of stuff that they don't necessarily agree with, so long as they see that someone's actually addressing it and hearing it. Mm-hmm. You know, we're all mature enough to recognize that we can't just magic the world into a perfect scenario for ourselves, and there's going to be trade-offs. However, we want to be heard. If we have a deep concern, we want that to be recognized. So I think The weekly AMAs are fantastic. I also think it's also quite a US thing. I've got to be honest. I think different cultures, I don't know many UK companies do this outside of, if like, the startup milieu maybe. But I can't imagine sort of some of the more venerable businesses in insurance or, you know, whatnot, public sector doing this type of activity. But maybe they need to, you know, as I think the trust level with employee to employer is going to be under challenge with the shift to remote, for instance, and, you know, how people are experiencing this mode of work. You know, leaders need to be very, very clear that trust is at stake, and they need to build it. Let's talk about this. Shift to remote is obviously not complete. It's going to be like working through process. People are going to do hybrid. They're going to do different flavors thereof. It will impact how we build software, because it's going to change how companies work. Now, I put it to you two that ATSs, the ATS space, was built on the fundamental premise that everyone was going to be in office as a full-time permanent employee, generally speaking. Like, you'd process, you deny it now, but...
I'm thinking about it. Hadn't thought of that.
I would say that is basically everything else. Like, as a user, everything else was like, oh, yeah, we can kind of hack this system to deal with a person that's part time, 3 days a week or whatever. But really, everything's processed with the idea that they're going to be there all the time. Now, what is going to happen with the shift to remote or the distributed way of working is that we're going to get lots of different types of worker working with businesses and interfacing with businesses. And I think that's going to change the way in which software will be produced or what kind of things software needs to happen. As the companies get more flexible, software needs to become more configurable, I would say. Is this something that you've thought about in terms of the roadmap for Greenhouse? Or have I got my understanding completely wrong about the market? Or have you already like pre-built like a super flexible system or whatnot?
I actually feel, I mean, like looking back over the last year and you say, well, what's changed? Like the truth is, you know, a lot of companies have people in more than one office anyhow. Like there's a lot of people who are building their work around working with people who aren't physically near them. And so in a lot of ways, when I look at like what changed, in some ways the recruitment process changed less than the onboarding process. So like recruiting, it's like, oh yeah, we used to do in-person interviews. Now they're over Zoom. It's like, that wasn't that hard to get your head around, right? Like people could kind of figure that out. The onboarding thing, I feel like was a much bigger departure where companies were far more dependent on, yeah, you're going to come into the office and you're going to be surrounded by your teammates and you're going to make friends and you're going to learn the culture and the social norms and you're going to learn your job. And all these things will happen just because you're sitting near your teammates. And now that doesn't happen at all. And so like you have to get way more intentional in how you create the space for them to like meet people and have like loose ties that aren't just the three people they work with every day. And so in a lot of ways, I think that's been our bigger focus. It was like that was like the bigger change was onboarding more than recruiting in some way.
And that's actually been quite a major feature in the product, hasn't it?
Yeah. So we've called Greenhouse onboarding product that like there's a lot of people who actually looked at it this year and said, well, I already have the paperwork stuff set up. Like I've got 1,000 employees, right? Like I've figured out how to get the paperwork done and get people onto payroll. And it's all in the HRIS system. And those processes all are set. I don't want to mess with them, but I'm super nervous about my new hire experience. So how do I engage that new hire before they even start? And how do I ensure that they're learning about the company and meeting people? And how do I know they're not going off the rails? And that became like a real first class concept of a worry. And so they said, is there something else? And so we kind of even built a version of our Greenhouse onboarding product just for those folks who said, I don't even need to do paperwork. I've already got that sorted elsewhere. I just need to focus on the new hire experience. And so that's become very successful.
Yeah, I think, again, you're absolutely right to focus the product effort in that area because I think it's a major concern for companies. I think, you know, shifting remote on-premise or whatnot is more comfortable for people that you've previously worked with and you've built social relationships with. The crisis is going to come when you're starting to hire new people for the first time in this distributed way. You're going to find out there's not this trust level simply because there isn't that sitting in next to each other over time type of experience. Osmotic information transfer is my smart term that I picked up somewhere to describe that.
Nice.
It wasn't my term, by the way. Google it. So some genius came up with it. But I think it describes exactly what it is. Like no one's directly tutoring you, you're just like ambiently absorbing this stuff. And we no longer have that, or at least we don't yet. Let's look at the product. Let's look at the roadmap as to what's happening. Already tons of stuff have happened in the product this year. What can customers expect towards the end of 2021? And you know, let's take it out. Next couple of years, what's happening with the product vision from there?
I mean, near term, there's all sorts of neat things happening in the next quarter or so. We're launching like kickoff meetings you can do inside the product, taking all the reports and customer reports you've been making and putting them onto dashboards. You can create your own kind of mix and match dashboards. We've just launched this like job ad marketplace where you can buy job ads on 1,000 different job boards. So there's a pile of kind of different tactics that are happening throughout this year that we're pretty confident are going to get a lot of take up. All this like automation stuff where you move into a state, candidate to a stage and automatically a bunch of things happen. And depending on what they do, they might move to the next stage automatically. And all of that stuff is really helpful for high volume. I think the big trend, if you pull back, is that, you know, we now have enough data about how companies are using the product and what's going well and badly, that the product itself can start to get a bit smarter. And so that instead of being kind of an empty shell that you pour stuff into and then kind of work the workflow levers, you say like, no, it's really about the product can now reflect back to you and say, hey, based on like you're opening this job, based on what you said in your kickoff meeting you're looking for, what's likely to happen? If you want to change that, if you said, well, actually I really care about diversity and I want to change the makeup of who's in my applicant pool, what could I do differently? If we want to make the hire by November 1st and it looks like we're actually on track for December 1st, what can we do differently to make that? And so I think we have all of those insights now. We're sitting on all that data and we're like, oh, let's start reflecting that back. And so people can make smarter decisions kind of live in the moment.
Yeah, very, very interesting. It would be wonderful for people to get a truly responsive system that, you know, isn't just a tool that gives you execution, but gives you like inputs to say, actually, Hung, do you remember doing this? You did this last time and you screwed it up. You know, don't do this. And then suddenly you've actually got a partner. Almost the software becomes a partner to the user. Rather than, you know, a tool that you have to put the mental effort into to manipulate.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah, when we first started, we talked about this idea of like, what role do we want Greenhouse, the software product, to play in the hiring team? And we sort of came up with this formulation. We said Greenhouse should be two things, the hiring team. It should be a concierge and a coach. So meaning it should take stuff off your plate. You go, oh, I got that for you. Don't worry about that. I can automate these stages, right? Do this stuff and make it way easier. And then the coach side is like, it should actually be like, hey, guess what? I got some tips for you. Or why don't you try this that you're not trying? And that concierge part, I think we've done a really good job of. And I think now, to John's point, because we've got the scale that we have and the data we have over so many years, the product can now start to look at providing a lot more of that insight back to you. And that's a really exciting opportunity.
I would love to see some sort of personality driven AI thing in Greenhouse to come and give me some advice, you know, something you could program.
Paperclip, I was going to say, right?
Yeah, we need Clippy. Clippy is a great idea. This is a terrible execution of it.
Clippy.
It was annoying. But imagine if you could do you could program like a Darth Vader or something like that and come and give you like Darth Vader style advice. I think that would be quite humorous, probably useless. But you know what? I think you'd get more love from the market if you implemented it.
2025. You know, I think people get very excited about AI. It sounds like a neat thing, and you know, marketers love to talk about it. I think that the things that get us excited are a little bit more maybe practical. When you think about what goes into making a really good hire, you end up making so many decisions that most hiring teams don't even realize that they're making. Like, what's actually on your scorecard for this role? You're opening up an engineering job or a sales job. Like, what are you actually going to evaluate those people based on? How many criteria should you be including? What interview questions are you going to ask? Who's going to be on the hiring team? How are you going to find the talent? Are you going to buy some job ads? Are you going to run an employer referral program? How many candidates should be in the funnel at the top of the stage? All these type of questions, most people don't really have a lot of data to go on. They just kind of pattern match, or they sort of do what feels right. And it's really often suboptimal. And, you know, to John's earlier point, like, so much data right now that we kind of almost know in real time, you know, if you're sourcing for this job in this city and you're like, oh, we're going to go hire this staffing agency and buy that job ad, we can be like, actually, there's like two other staffing agencies in town that are better at filling that kind of role than the one you just hired. Or if you buy this job ad, not that job ad, you're going to get like 25% more candidates of color. Most of our customers don't know those things. And the insights that we can start to surface to them through the product, I think, really can help them in very practical ways make smarter decisions. You don't have to go down Clippy Land to get there.
Well, Clippy's just an interface, Dan. I mean, you could. I just want to be able to talk to somebody. I'm too lonely.
Don't talk to your ATS. Talk to other people.
Hey, you know what? It's an interesting thing to talk about voice. I mean, we don't have the time to dive into it yet, but everything is still keyboard driven and screen based. You know, what is the future going to be looking like when we're talking about tooling that is moving away from this? You know, maybe 10, 15 years away, I don't know, but it will certainly happen. And that's maybe a future tense conversation for another time. Folks, we're coming to the end of the show, so I want to just ask a final question for you two. I'm thinking here, we're directing it particularly towards people who might be thinking about the entrepreneurial route for the first time. I think that's also something that is happening given the circumstances we've had. A lot more people are thinking, you know what, I'm going to do my own thing. What advice would you give that person, having gone through the entrepreneurial path yourself multiple times, particularly latterly with Greenhouse? What one piece of advice would you give? Let's go with you first, John.
Find a good partner. It's really hard to do alone. Having somebody who compliments you is really important.
Fantastic. And Dan, you can't say the same thing as what John said.
I think be really clear with yourself about why you're doing it. I think people get really interested in sort of the superficial stuff that you see maybe on TechCrunch or in the press. And the lived reality is often very different. So what do you really need out of the job? Why are you really starting that company? And if you can find that priority and let everything else go, I think you have a chance.
Yeah, fantastic. And that North Star, so to speak, is what's going to get you through the tough times and the tough moments, because that's the thing that is never going to fade away. So Dan and John, this has been a fantastic conversation. We could literally have another couple of hours chatting with you on this, but I am very conscious of the Greenhouse bottom line. And what I can't be doing is taking the two founders away for any more time than I already have. So as a final thing, what busy CEOing and founding stuff do you need to do for the rest of the day? What's on the agenda?
I have 12 new hires starting 1 minute ago, and I spend the first hour with them. Their first hour of time at Greenhouse is with me. So I have to go to that.
You got to go. And Dan, what are you doing?
I'm working on some top secret projects that I can't talk about yet.
Amazing. Okay, Dan and John, amazing chatting with you. Go and run a fantastic business. I'd love to have you on Founders Focus. It's been a fantastic chat. And thank you very much for your time. It's been fantastic.
Thanks for having us, Sam.
Thanks a lot. Appreciate it.
See ya.